Ship 29 on the pad. Flight 4 is coming. Ship 29 testing campaign continues. What's next? SpaceX scraps a legendary booster. Massey's flame trench parts are spotted. SpaceX launches the first Dragon from Slick 40, and RFA reveals their updated cargo capsule. My name is TJ. Welcome to What About It. Let's dive right in. Starship updates. Starbase is always buzzing with activity. In just 2 weeks since the last launch, the pace here hasn't slowed down a bit. Right now, SpaceX's main focus is getting the orbital launch mount back in its original condition. The latest pictures taken by photographer John reveal that the launch site might be a bit more battered than we originally thought. On March 20th, the SpaceX team was seen removing the booster quick disconnect hood, a metal piece designed to shield the fueling mechanisms during liftoff. A closer inspection of the connections reveals a worrying sight. The methane feed hose was torn to shreds during the launch. That's not good. It seems the launch pad avoidance maneuver, executed just after the engines roared to life, might be the culprit here. Protecting the tower from any harm, Starship launches at a slight tilt. Unfortunately, this causes the exhaust from the engines to hit the side of the launch deck opposite of the quick disconnect system. The metal sheet then likely directs this fiery blast straight back into the BQD, causing the extensive damage that we're observing. Word around the block is that for the fourth flight, SpaceX plans to delay the avoidance maneuver by a few seconds. While the damaged hoses may seem like a setback for rapid reusability, thankfully replacing them isn't too complicated of a task, and it is expected to be completed shortly. On a more positive note, just 2 days after addressing the damage, SpaceX engineers reinstalled the booster stabilization pins. These are required for aligning the Super Heavy with the launch table, hinting that the rollout of the next prototype could be just around the corner. Things look even more optimistic when we look at the upper stage of the fourth Starship, Ship 29. Last week, we saw a few signs of an upcoming rollout. A thorough inspection of Pad B as well as reactivation of the LR-11000 crane. As expected, merely 7 days after the launch, Ship 29 made its grand exit from the high bay and journeyed towards the launch site. Upon arrival, it was hoisted onto Pad B using the new lifting jig. Soon after, SpaceX shared some impressive photos from this event, reiterating that Ship 29 is slated for the fourth flight. More crucially, they've also mentioned that it's scheduled for static fires. Yes, plural, static fires. The plan seems to be the repeat of what we saw with Ship 28, so a 6-engine static fire, followed by a test featuring a single engine. The latter test aims to simulate Raptor's reignition in space, which will likely be once again the main goal of the upcoming mission. By the time you're watching this, there's a chance that the static fire might have already happened. Should the static fire have taken place, we'll show footage from it on screen right now. No matter if the test already occurred or not, the pace of progress is remarkable. After the second flight, SpaceX took more than a month to conduct the static fire for Ship 28. Now they were able to cut that time in under 2 weeks for Ship 29. Talk about efficiency. Following these tests, Ship 29 is expected to return to the high bay for final touches, such as installing covers for the Starlink antennas. It might also undergo modifications to address any issues identified during the third flight. With this tempo of progress, when do you expect we'll see the fourth launch? Could it be within the next 6 weeks, or is April off the table? Place your bets in the comments below. During our recent flyover, possible thanks to Redline helicopter tours, we were able to observe some exciting developments at the build site. Looking from the air, one of the first things to catch our eye was a Super Heavy booster inside the mega bay. It appeared as though we were witnessing a critical moment, stacking of the liquid oxygen and methane tanks. However, one picture often isn't enough to tell the whole story. This wasn't the assembly of a prototype on the brink of completion, instead it was the end of Booster 4. Just wanna moment of silence for Booster 4. Okay, for those who have been keeping track of the evolution of Starbase, you'll recall that Booster 4 together with Ship 20 were chosen as the first full stack to take to the skies. Yet, as Stage 0 was finalized, this pair had become technologically obsolete compared to SpaceX's newest prototypes, leading to the selection of Booster 7 and Ship 24 for the first launch. Since then, both prototypes have remained in the Rocket Garden untouched. Until recently. On March 6th, Booster 4 finally garnered some attention, albeit not the sort we had been hoping for. The removal of one of the grid fins was a bad sign, and indeed by March 21st, the prototype was transported to the first mega bay where it was cut in half. It was in the middle of the night, and I'm sitting there with the camera tracking it through the darkness on its way to its demise. The lock section was then rolled out for scrapping. While some of you may feel sad over Booster Force fate, it's important to remember that in the grand scheme of things, this prototype's role was ultimately minor. It's just one of potentially hundreds or even thousands of boosters that will participate in the Starship program. Farewell, Booster 4. Your chapter in the story of space exploration may be over, but the mission continues. In addition to clearing space for upcoming prototypes, SpaceX is making significant progress in constructing the necessary infrastructure for those colossal vehicles. A prime example of this development is the Star Factory, which is nearing completion. Most of the recent work has been focused on the factory's facade. Surprisingly, it turns out that in the end, we're getting what we had hoped for. The Star Factory is indeed being equipped with windows, suggesting that the final design may resemble the window layout as seen at the Starlink facility in Bastrop. While it may not match the insane wall of glass from the original render, these windows should still offer us a peek inside, letting us a glimpse of what SpaceX has been brewing in there. Significant developments are also underway at following foundation work. Construction had been started on the Star Factory's office mezzanine. This building, while compact, is set to rise 5 stories high and might eventually link directly to the main factory building. With some of the steel framework already in place and numerous metal beams prepared for assembly, it won't be long before we see this structure take shape. Moving behind the bays, we see progress on the 6-story parking garage. With most of the piling work wrapped up, excavators are now clearing out chunks of concrete, presumably to prepare for the installation of conduits and the garage's foundation. It seems, however, the building will occupy only the space of the original parking lot, not extending across the entire area behind the bays. Finally, at the Sanchez site, we see the most exciting development, the construction of the second Starship launch tower. They grew up so fast. The top section of this new tower is already mostly assembled, with work processed at an impressively rapid pace. Looking around, we also notice that 4 footings have been placed at the pads designated for tower sections. This indicates that the sections from the Port of Brownsville could be soon transported to the Sanchez site. The second tower is coming. It's incredible how much you can discover by just looking at things from the air. Did you know that you can take a helicopter ride over Starbase and get the same kind of views that you can see in our videos? Visit redlineheli.com/Felix to book your very own helicopter ride over Starbase with $25 off. You'll never forget this. Finally, let's delve into the experiments at the new Starship Testing Center, also known as Massey's Test Site. Initially dedicated solely to cryogenic testing, Massey's will allow conducting ship static fires as early as this year. Let's start with the flame trench itself. The structure seems largely complete, with excavators already clearing soil from within the trench. Interestingly, a very thick concrete wall can also be found in front of the trench. It's so wide that it matches the width of the trench walls. There's not enough data to tell us its purpose, but it is something definitely worth keeping an eye on. Adjacent to the trench, you can see the newly installed water tanks, which also received the much needed layer of fresh paint. This site also seeing the installation of smaller tanks and high pressure vessels, so this may be a scaled down version of the water supply system found at the launch site. However, the deluge system itself will be entirely different. To see it, we have to move over to the liquid oxygen supply area. Here, next to the deluge base, are segments of metal walls intended for installation within the trench itself. Yet the most critical element is situated right next to these wall pieces. This part, made of multiple metal pipes, will be used as a flame deflector. Previous images of these pipes showed various colored markings, likely indicating the density or size of the holes to be drilled, essentially for the diverter's function. Currently, only 1/2 of the diverter is at Massey's, and the second one is en route to Starbase, as spotted by a few people online. The deluge design itself looks really familiar to what Relativity Space uses for their engine test stands. This setup serves a dual purpose. It not only cools the structure, but also transforms sound waves into heat, mitigating the intense acoustic energy produced during static fires. The final element of this puzzle is the static fire test stand. We can actually find it within the ship and booster testing area. This stand's design is notably distinct from anything we've seen before at Starbase. It's really heavy duty. It has 4 legs, resembling a spider or a futuristic robot. The precise method by which SpaceX plans to move both stand and the prototypes over the trench is a mystery still. Historically, testing infrastructure at Massey's has been mobile, allowing equipment like the ship test stand to be easily transported to the high bay where a prototype was placed on top of it. This new stand will either require some crazy SPMT setup, or perhaps we'll finally see a dedicated crane and ship lifter at Massey's. What's your take on this? Do you think SpaceX will opt for lifting prototypes, or will they stick with their strategy of mobile test stands? Share your thoughts in the comments below. Now, you've watched more than half of the video and you're still watching. Thank you. this means you like it. We've looked into our channel metrics and there are over 2 million returning monthly viewers who have not subscribed yet. Help us improve the channel even further by double checking that you've hit that subscribe button so you don't miss our weekly updates. While you're at it, give us a like and become a Y supporter for exclusive SpaceX updates. With it, you get access to daily Starbase photo galleries, including satellite, aerial, and ground photos of SpaceX's progress and countless other extras on top. And no matter how much you decide to give, everyone gets the same supporter content access. You decide what you want to give. For all of those who watched IFT3 with us or somewhere else, I have something very special. So brand new that I don't even have the shirt yet. Our IFT3 commemorative shirt. If you loved IFT3, this is something you'll want to have. Designed by our very own Alex and on the shop right now. The shirt is tagged in our video as well. The link to our Patreon page and our new website is in the description. Thanks to all supporters who help us fund more crazy projects. We cannot thank you enough. You rock. Now, before we get back to the news, let's hear a word about brushing your teeth from our sponsor.
Let's talk about a sticky situation. Sharing toothbrushes. Felix and I recently tried out the Lumino electric toothbrush, and we're quite impressed.
Woo! Awesome!
However, the challenge of sharing it by swapping hands was not ideal. How can we lip sync to music as a family without separate toothbrushes?
Nah!
Then our second Lumino electric toothbrush arrived, and a third one. Crafted by a leading American dentist, Lumino is backed by over 65 scientific clinical studies available on their website, ensuring its effectiveness. It deep cleans debris and plaque with uncompromising care, offering 5 personalized cleaning modes. It surpasses typical electric toothbrushes. Its gentle yet effective bristles ensure my gums are healthy along with my appetite for the spotlight. I love the Lumino toothbrush because it instills me with confidence about my smile. With recyclable heads, I dance carefree knowing I'm supporting an eco-conscious company. Click the Amazon link in the description to get $10 off your Lumino electric toothbrush order with fast shipping.
Thanks, Steffi. Now, going back to the news, we have a bunch of events related to one of humanity's greatest projects, the International Space Station. As many of you might know, the ISS isn't a self-sustaining system. It relies on a steady influx of supplies from Earth to support astronauts living in orbit. SpaceX, among other companies, plays a crucial role in ferrying cargo to the station via their Dragon 2 capsule every few months. Generally, these resupply missions aren't that exciting, primarily delivering food, water, and scientific experiments to the onboard crew. However, the CRS-30 launch stood out for a unique reason. It was the first Dragon V2 launched from launch pad other than 39A. In case you've missed it, over the past year, Elon Musk's company has been constructing a second tower. Basically, NASA wasn't happy with SpaceX wanting to test Starship at the US's only launch pad capable of supporting human spaceflight. I wonder why. And this led to the selection of the Space Launch Complex 40, or SLC 40, as backup site. After the construction of the second tower finished at the end of 2023, SpaceX considered using new setup for the Axiom 3 mission back in January. In the end, they decided to wait, taking additional time to thoroughly test all the systems. One notable feature recently shown of SLC 40 is the emergency escape system designed to protect the crew members if something went terribly wrong with the rocket. While LC-39A used escape baskets attached to a zipline for rapid evacuation, SLC 40 features an emergency chute, an adrenaline-pumping escape slide. Honestly, I'd jump at the chance to give it a try. As anticipated, the launch proceeded without a hitch, successfully delivering the payload to the ISS. Unfortunately, the same thing can't be said for another ISS-bound mission that was scheduled just 2 days after the Dragon launch. On March 21st, the Soyuz MS-25 mission was poised to lift off from Baikonur Cosmodrome, but the launch was abruptly aborted just 20 seconds before ignition. The source of the problem was identified to be a battery issue, with its voltage falling outside the acceptable range. After replacing the battery, the capsule successfully launched on its journey to the station. This crew, comprised of Russian cosmonaut Oleg Novitsky, Marina Veselskaya, the first Belarusian woman in space, and the American astronaut Tracy Dyson. The capsule docked to the ISS on March 25th, marking yet another first for human spaceflight. For now, the leaders of the crew and cargo deliveries for the station are the United States and Russia, but this may change in the future. Some of you may not remember, but there was a period when the European Space Agency operated its own cargo cargo delivery system. Between 2008 and 2015, the ISS frequently welcomed visits from the Automated Transfer Vehicle, or ATV for short. Although it was designed to be expendable, the ATV boasted impressive capabilities, delivering up to 7,500 kilograms or 16,500 pounds of supplies to the station. To put that into perspective, the ATV could transport twice the cargo load compared to today's SpaceX Dragon. Despite the ATV's success, ESA discontinued the program due to issues related to equipment and component obsolescence, a diplomatic way of saying that there was a lack of political support. The final ATV mission was deorbited in 2015, and since then, ESA has depended on its international partners for cargo delivery to the ISS. However, this reliance might change soon. In 2023, ESA invited proposals from European companies for a new commercial cargo capsule. One of the proposals came from Rocket Factory Augsburg, a German company working on a small-sided launcher dubbed RFA-1. Their capsule is named Argo. And what does it stand for? Essentially, Argo implies cargo without the C, where the C stands for cost, symbolizing a version of an affordable cargo solution. That's kind of fun. Cargo, Argo, I like it. It's also like a cool just word. The initial version of the Argo capsule was designed to transport up to 3,400 kilograms or 7,500 pounds to the station, offering 13 cubic meters or 460 cubic feet of pressurized space, all while being fully reusable. Now, in March, they released an updated proposal that promises even more impressive specifications. Firstly, the capsule's dimensions have been revealed, 3.7 meters or 12 feet in diameter, and 7.7 meters or 25 feet in length. RFA also bumped up the payload capacity to 4,000 kilograms or 8,800 pounds, expanding the pressurized volume to 15.5 cubic meters or 550 cubic feet. Embracing a material loved by SpaceX, the company has chosen stainless steel for the construction of both RFA-1 rocket and the capsule itself. For maneuverability in space, Argo rely on two Fenix engines and 24 thrusters, each delivering 100 newtons of thrust. Just like most of the new spacecraft on the market, RFA spacecraft will autonomously dock with the ISS instead of relying on berthing used by example the original Dragon capsule. This will likely involve a variation of the International Docking System standard, enabling Argo to dock not only with the ISS but with future commercial stations like VAST, Axiom, and potentially the Lunar Gateway. Given that the RFA-1 lacks the capacity for such a hefty payload, the capsule is being engineered for compatibility with other medium and heavy launchers, likely including Falcon 9, Ariane 6, and Vulcan Centaur. One interesting aspect of Argo's design is its fully cylindrical shape, which couldn't survive re-entry if it used a simple ablative heat shield. So how will it overcome this? Through the use of an inflatable atmospheric decelerator, or IAD for short. This inflatable heat shield should not only safeguard the capsule from re-entry heat, but also decelerate it, eliminating the need for parachutes for splashdown. Remarkably, the IAD also allows Argo to return to Earth with a cargo load identical to what it delivers, up to 4,000 kilograms or 8,800 pounds. Even more appealing is the anticipated operational cost, estimated at just half of what ESA paid for the ATV missions, amounting to a mere 150 million euros. Currently, Argo is in the development phase, with a demonstration launch targeted for 2028 and operational service beginning in 2029. There was a time when Europe was making significant waves in space exploration, but then progress seemed to stall out. Fingers crossed here for a successful comeback. And that's it for today. Remember to smash that like button, subscribe for more awesome content. This is what fuels the algorithm and helps us immensely. Check out our epic shirts at your favorite nerd store. Link is in the description. And if you want to train your space IQ even further, watch this video to continue your journey. Thank you very much for watching, and we'll see you guys in the next episode. Bye. Could it be within the next... There's Neil. Hey, Neil. I'm gonna... Gosh, boy. Gosh. Why am I doing this? My jersey's coming out.